with Claude. Claude, so professor and astronaut. We're going to present about Chandra, so he's more a specialist of Hubble, I guess.
That's right.
But he's going to try and do something with Chandra. So we're going to explain how to put a satellite into orbit using the space shuttle, as this is something quite trivial for him. And hopefully this will be trivial for us after this presentation.
Science, not going to be entertaining. I found this picture is pretty nice, although what is wrong about this picture, this artist view, I would say, of Chandra Hall. Do you know the inclination of the orbit of Chandra? Yeah, I think it's coming over Patagonia more or less, or even further south, and I don't think the inclination of Chandra is so high, but that's a big debate. It's a pretty nice artist view anyway. This field is still working. First, I think we need to honor Chandra Zekar, because Chandra was named after Subrahmanyan Chandra Zekar, who is a great astronomer. And, in the last century, we had a few astronomers that did shine, and Chandra Zekar was one of them. And I like this picture also. He was a very, very fine man and very, very talented. Studied in India and then in England, then went to Chicago. And he won the Nobel Prize in 1983 with William Powell for key discovery that led to the country accepted theory of later evolutionary stages of massive stars. And there is a Chandra Zekar limit. If you have a star that is above 1.4 solar masses, it will collapse not into a dwarf. White dwarf, but into a neutral star, and if it is much more massive, it will collapse into a black hole. So he is the one who really discovered all of this, and this was really a remarkable achievement. So I think it's a good opportunity to honor the memory of Chandra Zekar, who passed away in 1990. One of the greatest astronomers of the last century. Without any doubt. Okay, this has been shown already, so I don't want to insist on this. The windows of transparency of the atmosphere, where we have, of course, the visible part of the spectrum, part of the infrared, although it's partly absorbed by some molecules like water vapor and carbon dioxide and so on. Then it opens again in the radio region, starting with the millimeter waves. You know, you have one observatory, ground-based observatory in Chile, Alma, Atacama, large millimeter array. The millimeter waves correspond to, of course, pretty cold matter in the universe. This is the opposite end of the spectrum versus what Chandra is observing, the X-rays. Alma is at 5,000 meters above sea level in the Chilean Andes, and you get a good amount of millimeter waves at 5,000, you get hardly any at sea level. And of course, in space you have everything, but you can start about here, but there's partial absorption, and when you go high, that's why Alma is so high. If you have the opportunity to go visit Alma, it's really a magnificent site, high in the chilling energy. And of course, the radio window is quite open. That's the artist's view of the Chandra, has been described already, and these have been described also, this interesting feature of these grazing incidents, focusing elements that produce an image here. From a purely technical point of view, to produce these reflecting surfaces was quite a challenge. So that was a remarkable achievement by the industrial team that built Chandra, as well as Exxon and Newton, by the way. This has been presented already, in fact, even in more detail. There was a video, the lift-off. This is a real lift-off for the Columbia in July 1999. On a five-day mission only, the mass of Chandra plastic entering upper stage, the stage that was going to be able to put it to that very high elliptical orbit, so it was very high, it was about 23 metric tons. That's about the maximum that the shuttle could carry. And that's the reason why the mission was so short. They could not fill all the tanks with the propellants for all the maneuvers on orbit. And the shuttle was always a compromise. The mission that didn't have too high payload were normally longer because they could take more propellant. For missions that were very critical in performance, took less propellant, and here they had only a very short mission. In addition to deploying Chandra, which was not an easy task, but it was not an extremely complicated task, and it was done from inside with switches and tilt the system, which was Chandra plus the interim upper stage, and then it was spring deployed from the shuttle. But they had a lot of other experiments, a few other experiments they performed. And the idea was on shuttle flight, which were always, by definition, short, maximum about 14 days. Whenever the main action was performed, there were more experiments to be executed in order to use the time on orbit. But again, they were performance limited and could only stay for 5 days. This is the crew, and it was the first shuttle flight where we had a woman commander, Eileen Collins. She flew again as a commander on STS-114, which was the first shuttle flight after the Columbia accident in the summer of 2005. Eileen Collins, really a remarkable person. I never flew in space with her. I flew T-38 quite often, and she was extremely respected and a very, very talented woman. And the rest of the crew, Jeff Ashby was the pilot. Steve Hawley, very good American astronomer, he's astronomer, astronaut, he was both. Katie Coleman here, and we had Michel Tognini, ESA astronaut. It was his first and only flight on the shuttle. Lift off at night. And you've seen this picture already, so the Chandra and the interim upper stage filled basically the whole field of day. It was quite a bit narrower than Hubble. Hubble filled it not only in length, but also in a width, but Chandra was a little bit narrower. And here you see, this is a picture taken on the ground with the payload bay doors open in the orbiter processing facility, the OPF at Kennedy Space Center, Florida. You see Chandra itself. And then you see this upper stage, interim upper stage, which was a pretty standard upper stage that had been fitted to Chandra, but had been fitted to a lot of communication satellite in order to bring them to the geosynchronous orbit, 36,000 kilometers above their surface. And here you see it was on a kind of a structure where it could be rotated upward. Obviously, if you want to spring deploy it, you need to take it in a proper position so you don't collide with the forward back end of the fuselage. the width of the payload bay of the shuttle was about 5 meters. And you see in the back one of the pods containing the propellants for the attitude control system, reaction control system in the back of the orbiter and in the front also. And here it's ready to be spring deployed. And the altitude of deployment was 280 kilometers, which was very typical of shuttle missions. We normally didn't have orbits below that because the friction of the high atmosphere was too high. At 200 kilometers, it was hardly possible to have an orbit. 250 was relatively common, 300 more common, and Hubble was at 600. And in the deployments, we had this is the initial shuttle orbit, and IUS interim upper stage had two stages, and the first was fired and it put it to this orbit, the elliptical orbit with a quite high eccentricity, and then another burn by the second stage of the interim upper stage brought it to this orbit, and then there was another propulsion system associated with Chandra, the IPS, and it had two burns, so eventually put it to this orbit. And then if you want, when you are at the apogee of an elliptical orbit, you want to raise the perigee, and then you do a burn at the apogee itself. So they did three burns. Every time it was at the apogee, it was being in order to raise the perigee of the orbit to a high value. And finally, they had this orbit that was 15,000 approximately for the perigee. That's to the center of the Earth. And 435,000 approximately for the apogee. And the idea was to have an orbit that was taking it out of the Allen belts for doing the observations. When it was going in the perigee in the Van Allen belt, it's not very good for the systems, but they didn't collect any data at that time. They were only collecting data when they were definitely out of the Van Allen belt in that part of the orbit. But you know, you have to imagine this was a very massive spacecraft. I mentioned 23 tons. Of course, that's not the weight of Chandra. It was Chandra plus the upper stage, which was very, very, very heavy. The weight of Chandra, I don't exactly know, but it's about 6 tons or so. It's still pretty, pretty massive. We have to talk about mass calculator. Okay, that was a crew. Our gratitude to these men and women who did it. Shuttle was pretty dangerous, and every shuttle mission, you had to think about what you were doing. But whether it was deploying a satellite, or it was doing an assembly mission for the International Space Station, or fixing Hubble, every time you were taking a risk. More so than Soyuz, for instance. As far as the Crew Dragon, we don't know because they just had a problem on the journey about a week ago. So we don't know that, human spacecraft is pretty dangerous, but the shuttle was considered as a not very safe vehicle. With two major accidents out of 135 missions, that was not very reassuring. So, we can thank these people who did it. And I didn't come in with the commander, and that was quite an achievement. Okay, well, the shuttle was used to deploy another great observatory. In fact, the picture I showed with the windows of transparency atmosphere, you may have seen, I didn't point that out, but there were three telescopes. There was one in the X-ray region, which was not Chandra, it was in fact XMM Newton, but very similar, because it was a picture provided by ESA. And the optical window with the Hubble Space Telescope, and we had a Spitzer telescope in the infrared. So these telescopes are about the atmosphere. They have available the whole spectrum of the electromagnetic waves. Hubble was put in the optical radiation part of this spectrum of electromagnetic waves. The idea was to get a telescope in the visible part of the spectrum with high resolution, the highest resolution possible. Because as you know, for an optical system, the resolution is a function of the diameter of the primary mirror. 2.4 meter primary mirror diameter is not great compared to big observatories on the ground, but once you're in space, you have a real theoretical resolution. And for 2.4 meter diameter, it's about 1/20th of an arc second, which is way better than anything you get on the ground, even with very large telescope, if you don't have adaptive optics, of course. So that's the deployment of Hubble in April 1990 from the Space Shuttle. Picture taken from the back of the payload, looking forward. It's a forward bulkhead of the payload bay. The robot arm just released it. It was filling the whole payload bay, because the solar wings were folded. They've been unfolded, and every time we're deploying something like this, we orient the solar wings to the sun to provide a charge fully in the batteries before we release it. 28,000 kilometers an hour, it's formation flight between Hubble and the shuttle, 28,000 kilometers an hour. It's really cool. And of course, the shuttle was used then to do several servicing missions. And I think what is important, this is taken on a mission that I was on, which was the first servicing mission in December 1993. 3.5 years after its deployment on orbit, we had, of course, this big optical problem. We had to change the solar arrays, which had a problem, and a few other components, including gyroscopes. The two weak components of Hubble are really the batteries and the gyroscopes. Batteries were still okay, but some gyroscopes had failed. And that's the fifth out of five spacewalks where we changed the solar arrays. You see there are here they are deployed. Of course, they can be rolled in, and then these can be turned 90 degrees against the skin of the telescope, and that's what we did here in order to change them. And we had new folding solar arrays in the payload bay. We are 600 kilometers over Australia. Quite a nice picture. What a view. And that's Jeff Hoffman's storing X-ray during that fifth spacewalk of this first servicing mission of Hubble. Now, you have to understand that the question was asked before about the obsolescence of Chandra. The huge plus of the ability to service Hubble or to visit Hubble was not only to fix it if something was broken, but to keep it as a modern scientific instrument. It was deployed in 1990, as mentioned. So the CCD cameras on focus dated from the late 80s. And if you had a digital camera with of that age, you wouldn't use it anymore because there has been so much improvements in the scientific instruments and the CCD arrays. So the last visit of Hubble was in 2009, so it's pretty recent. And it is still a modern scientific instrument that works fine. And it's modern, it was kept modern because it was possible to visit it, which was not the case for any of the other great observatories. Happy crew. Pete Cabby, Jeff Hoffman, Ben Barasov, Dominicos, Katie Fulton, we had a woman on board also, Story Masquerade and myself, with the new solar arrays, which we had exchanged on that first servicing mission. The old one had no thermal installation on the tension bars, metal tension bars of the solar wings, and at every sunrise and every sunset there was a thermal shock that was moving the solar rays and depointing the telescope. It points with an accuracy of 7,000 of an arc second, which resolution mentioned is 120 of an arc second. But it has an extremely high pointing accuracy. It could not maintain the pointing accuracy at every sunrise and sunset because of the thermal shock on the tension bar of the solar array, so we replaced them. everything we did on that mission in 1993 could be checked by the ground as being satisfactory, except the optical improvement. We didn't know that until early 1994. That picture of Messier 100 was shown at the Congress by Barbara Mikulski. The problem with Hubble is over, I remember her statement. And for us, it was a huge reward to see the future of a galaxy with the old system, the primary mirror suffering from this pretty bad spherical aberration. And after installing the optical corrector, we had really pictures that were pretty sharp. And for me, as an astronomer, having become an astronaut and visiting Hubble, the biggest reward was the first Hubble deep field. That was done about 6 months later, in the middle of 1994. 10-day exposure in a small L-shaped window in the constellation Big Dipper. It's basically three square fields. There was another small one here that I deleted. It was a very small extra area, a small square field. But anyway, this is the basic first Hubble Deep Field, and this was extraordinary. In this small window where you basically saw nothing and you exposed for 10 days with this very high resolution of Hubble and an object that was always visible from the orbit of Hubble, because with the inclination of 28 degrees, the object close to the north celestial pole and south celestial pole are always visible, they're never hidden by the Earth. And after that you see hundreds of galaxies. This was a I would say, enormous emotion to realize the extraordinary density of galaxies in our universe that was revealed in the first deep field. There were a lot of other deep fields that were made afterward, but that was the first one, and that was the one that, for me, was an extraordinary positive shock. And a reward for the mission we had done, and of course so many people who had worked on the optical corrector design and manufacture, that was not easy. But this was a fantastic reward, the Hubble Deep Field, the first one. Trained for another visit to Hubble, foreseen for end of 1999. We had a problem with the gyroscope. We had lost 4 out of 6, and we needed to replace all 6. Plus, fine guidance sensor, the main computer had to be trained in the water to simulate weightlessness. And here we are, service edition 3A, PDA number 2. I'm here at the end of the hour changing fine guidance sensor number 2, which had failed. We are again over Australia, 600 kilometers. This is my call, my colleague. You see, he has a safety tether here. Very important. If you go spacewalking, put your safety tether. Because if you let go and you go on your orbit, which separates from your orbit and your spaceship, it's really a bad day. We changed position. I was on the arm here, and I came off the arm, and my colleague Mike told us, yeah, I'm here. Holding the edge of the door, avionic bay number 1, where we changed the main computer to Hubble, so it was brain surgery. Right? Safety tether, yeah. I say hello, you see I have my head down, the reflection of the Earth on the horizon is coming. And you see the lamps, we spent 8 hours outside, so we're 5 times around the Earth, which is day night, and during the night we illuminate the place of work with this floodlight. But I was pretty happy. I mean, spacewalking, it's really hard. It's also follow a timeline. Many people think that spacewalking, you open the outer hatch, you have a magnificent view of the Earth and the stars, and you enjoy it. Yeah, you enjoy it, but it's timeline, it's work, and it's a responsibility. We reached Hubble on Christmas Day. It's taking out with the robot arm out of the plane of the Earth. Beautiful view just before sunset, crescent of the Earth, about 2 minutes before sunset. Unbelievable. Really incredible. And I like this picture a lot. This is taken when Hubble was brought with the robot arm vertical of the plane of the Earth until we got the go to release it. And you see the Earth is also, the sun is close to the horizon. This is the Earth illuminated by the sun. This is the area where you have sunset. The sun illuminated the plane of the bay and a reflection on the bottom of the telescope. It's just beautiful. The views you have up there are unbelievable. Always very high contrast. Here on the Earth, because of the atmosphere, you have relatively low contrast. Up there you have very, very sharp contrast. Always. We deployed Hubble. It was Christmas Day, 25th of December. So we took a picture of the crew. There were all Americans except Jean-François Clairvoy, who was a robot arm operator. The position I had for the first service mission, he was our robot arm operator. And I mentioned already the deep field. That's not a formal deep field, but typically the kind of picture that Hubble takes, which is circular. And you have stars in the foreground with the cross because of the diffraction effect. They are basically point-like point objects, so you have the diffraction. But all the other objects that don't have a cross are galaxies. And you have one spiral galaxy, which is pretty nice here. We have some elliptical galaxies. You probably have a galaxy which is resulting from the gravitational lens, was distorted by the high mass of some of the galaxies here. This is extraordinary. I mean, for the astrophysics to look at faraway objects or objects as they were a long time in the past, it's really a magnificent instrument. Still working fine. We can't go visit it anymore because we need the shuttle for that. The shuttle was retired in 2011, but it's working fine. Okay, I finished with Hubble, and one day in 1985, the shuttle was used to deploy not on the side of the human being. So that's not for sure. We deploy some human beings, but of course they have to put a spacesuit on, they have to deploy human beings with light clothing. And that's an extraordinary picture.
Was this one Pedro as well?
Sorry?
Was this one, this astronaut, on a Pedro as well?
Yeah.
I hope so.
Yes. Yeah, this Bruce McCandless, an American astronaut, flying formation with a shuttle. No safety feathers because he has a propulsion system. All right, well, that's all I'm going to do today. Nice picture of a shuttle.